And we're back talking about the legend and mythology that inspired the Wheel of Time. Now, this is why I created this YouTube channel, but reaction videos get so many more views. My first video on this channel was all about Norse mythology in the Wheel of Time. And if you thought Robert Jordan borrowed a lot from the Vikings, just wait and see how much he robbed from us Brits. I grew up with stories of King Arthur and his Knights of the Round Table. The Sword in the Stone was my favourite Disney film when I was a child. As I got older, I began to read more into the mythology, like Geoffrey of Monmouth's The History of the Kings of Britain. In fact, I think, yep, would recommend. What I love about Arthurian legend is how closely linked it is to our actual past. It is still debated whether Arthur is just a legendary hero or a real-life ruler whose reign has been embellished in folklore. Whichever side of the coin you fall on, there is no denying that some of the stories are tied to real geographical locations, like the site of Arthur's conception at Tintagel Castle in Cornwall. You can actually visit Merlin's cave, where the wizard used magic to disguise Uther Pendragon as the Duke of Cornwall so that he could sneak into the castle. A great day out if you ever get the opportunity. Safe to say, I'm a big King Arthur fan, and so it seems was Robert Jordan. Perhaps the biggest and most notable inspiration Robert Jordan borrowed from Arthurian legend are the names of characters, places, and objects in the Wheel of Time. In fairness, naming things is hard. It might not surprise you that I spent a lot of time as a kid, and admittedly an adult, drawing maps of made-up fantasy worlds, and naming things was always such a pain in the arse. So I have nothing negative to say about Robert Jordan modifying some pre-existing fantasy names for his own world, despite how on the nose some of these are. Starting with character names, and in no particular order, we have Arthur Hawkwing, a famous ruler who unified many nations to form one massive unified kingdom. Sound familiar? Well, it should do, because that is effectively what King Arthur did.
I am Arthur, King of the Britons.
King of the who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
Well, we all are. We are all Britons. And I am your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
Arthur's father was called Uther Pendragon, and flipping the paternal relationship, Arthur Hawkwing's son is named Luther Peyendrag. In fact, the term Pendragon means dragon's head or head dragon, perhaps a seed of inspiration for using the term dragon as a title. And as a result of this, Ran slash Luz Theron and King Arthur's sigil are the same. Moving on to modern day rulers, and we have the Queen of Andor, Morgaes Trakand, whose name bears a striking resemblance to Arthur's stepsister, Morgaes, mother of Sir Gawain, Knight of the Round Table, and protagonist of The Green Knight. Now, you might have already clocked how similar Sir Gawain's name is to Queen Morgaes' son, the First Sword of Andor, and frontrunner for most infuriating character in the series, Garwin Trakand. Let's stick with Knights of the Round Table for now, and next up we have Sir Galahad, whose name is quite clearly the inspiration for Galahad, Queen Morgaes' stepson and Garwin's half-brother. Now let's talk about the famous Sir Lancelot, and if you take away the Salot, you get everybody's favourite warder, Lan. Here's a fun game you can play. Say Tom Merrillan's last name over and over again really quickly, and it almost sounds like Merrillan, 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 Merrillan. It is fun. Another name possibly inspired by Arthur's famous druid advisor is the Arm Merlin Seat. Remember we were talking about Sir Gawain? Well, he actually had a younger brother called Mordred, who in legend is responsible for Arthur's death, and whose name bears a striking resemblance to Moradin, the reincarnation of Ishamael, and frontrunner for Forsaken of the Year for the 300th year in a row. And now for my favourite character, Nynaeve, whose name is quite clearly inspired by...
Who? Who? I'd like to know who!
Nynaeve, the mythical Lady of the Lake, who gives Arthur his legendary sword, Excalibur. More on that later.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government.
supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Lastly, we have Egwene Alvear and her namesake, Queen Guinevere, Arthur's wife and ruler of Camelot. Speaking of Camelot, there are a few places in the Wheel of Time that you could argue are inspired by legendary Arthurian locations. The first is the Andorran capital Caemlyn, which can be linked to Arthur's own seat of power, Camelot. The second is the Aes Sedai HQ, Tar Volan, which is likely named after Avalon, the mythical fairyland where Arthur is taken after he falls in battle. This has double significance as the term Aes Sedai actually comes from a Celtic word for fairy. Lastly, we have objects which have similar names and properties to Arthurian artifacts. The term Ungrial and its variations Sar Ungrial and Ter Ungrial likely come from the name for the Holy Grail, Sung Rial, meaning royal blood. Other Wheel of Time objects that could have been inspired by the mythical chalice include the Bowl of Winds, which can change the weather, and the Eye of the World, the book version, not the one from the show. Both the Eye and the Grail are described as residing in a specific location, but may appear anywhere and are only obtainable via a great need. The most obvious nod towards Arthurian legend in the Wheel of Time, in my opinion, is the magical sword Calendor. As previously mentioned, Arthur had his own bewitched blade called Excalibur. You might be thinking Calendor and Excalibur, they don't sound that similar. But get this, the original Latin name for Arthur's sword used by Geoffrey of Monmouth is Caliburn. In legend, Arthur is given Excalibur by the Lady of the Lake, but this is only after he breaks his original sword in a duel with King Pellinor. This weapon is the famous sword which Arthur pulled from an anvil atop a stone in order to prove he was the rightful King of England. In the Wheel of Time, Calendor is kept in the Stone of Tyr and can only be wielded by the true Dragon Reborn. Therefore, you could argue that both Rand and Arthur prove their title by taking a sword from a stone. But Rand and Arthur have more in common than just weaponry. Both were adopted at a young age and not raised by their biological parents. The conception of both legendary characters can also be linked to deception. In Arthur's case, his father Uther Pendragon had Merlin disguise him as the Duke of Cornwall so he could seduce the Duke's wife, Egwene. After the Duke was killed in battle that night, Egwene believed she had been impregnated by her husband's spirit. Rand's biological mother and all-round badass is not so subtly called Tigraine. She is originally the daughter heir of Andor, but abandons her future throne to become a maiden of the spear amongst the Aiel and takes the name Shael. She then falls in love with a clan chief called Janduin, and together the two conceive Rand. Therefore, in both cases, we have a parent who is not who they claim to be. Throughout this video, there have been some small spoilers for some of the earlier books, but the final similarity between Rand and King Arthur does reveal some details about the actual ending. So if you haven't finished A Memory of Light, I would leave this video here.
You have chosen wisely.
The final nod towards Arthurian legend in the Wheel of Time is Rand's funeral. When Min meets Rand for the first time, she has a viewing of three women standing around a funeral byre with him atop it. This viewing is fulfilled when Min, Aviendha, and Elaine light Rand's funeral pyre after the last battle. Of course, we know that Rand isn't really dead after some last-minute body switching with Moradin, but the imagery is remarkably similar to Arthur's own demise after the Battle of Camlann. Camlann. How is it only during recording that I'm only noticing this one? Stupid. After Arthur is mortally wounded by Mordred, he is taken to the island of Avalon, escorted by three magical women. And there we have it. Those are all the Arthurian legends that inspired characters and events in the Wheel of Time, that I know of. If there are any that I missed that you know of, please do let me know in the comments down below. As always, please do like and share this video, and let me know if you would like to see more legendary and mythology content like this, because honestly, I love making it, and I will probably make more. So subscribe if you would like to see that. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you next time. As I got older, I began to read more into the mythology, like Joffrey of Monmouth's The Histories of the... As I got older, I began to read more into the mythology, like Joffrey of Monmouth. That is a hard word to say. Blah, blah, blah. Yes, rum will help.